So let's do some practicing. Also, I mean, so I'm going to show you stuff. You guys are welcome to work along with me, right? Like, it's, I mean, I know I can do it. You also probably know whether or not you can do it or not. So let's go ahead and do things. But if you want a chance to like actually do some of the problems on your own, let me know and I'll like do it. Okay. But let's talk about problem is with it's hard with the people at home. So I'm like, yeah, you can do it on your own if you want, but I can't like walk around and see what you're doing. So I'm still going to kind of just show because that's the way we've been doing it so far. It seems to work all right. Okay. So the first problem is f of x equal to sine of x cubed times the arc sine of x to the fifth. And we're being asked to find the derivative and do not simplify our answers. So definitely if you, oftentimes people will ask questions like this on exams where they don't want you to simplify, you really shouldn't simplify. You're just giving yourself an opportunity to lose points if you simplify. So let's see, I'm gonna have to use the product rule and the chain rule a couple times here. I've got f prime of x. So the derivative of sine of x cubed is gonna be cosine of my stuff times the derivative of my stuff times the other function plus, then we switch it up, right? We're using the product rule. So I'm gonna leave the first part alone, sine of x cubed. And then multiply by the derivative of the arc sine of x to the fifth. So the derivative of arc sine of x is 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. So the derivative of arc sine of some stuff is 1 over the square root of 1 minus my stuff squared times the derivative of my stuff. And I'm really going to take the not simplifying to heart. I'm just going to leave it like that. Right, totally would be easy, right? That is x to the 10th and you do a couple of things, but we don't need to. We're not gonna simplify. I should also remind you all, if you have questions along the way, please ask. I'm happy to explain anything in greater detail. But let's look at the next question. Our function is the natural log of e to the 2x times tangent to the fourth of x divided by the square root of 6x plus 1. And although this problem specifically says to not simplify your answer, it doesn't say we can't simplify before we find our answer. In fact, we definitely should simplify this expression using our logarithmic rules before we find our answer. So I'm going to rewrite this as the natural log of e to the 2x plus the natural log, whoops, the natural log, sorry, I can't read it there, of tangent to the fourth of x minus the natural log of 6x plus 1 to the 1/2. And then before I take the derivative, I'm going to do one further thing. I'm going to bring down my powers. That's going to be 2x times the natural log of e plus 4 times the natural log of tangent of x minus 1/2 times the natural log of 6x plus 1. And before we differentiate this, or differentiate the whole thing, I'm just going to make note of the fact that the natural log of e is just 1. So now differentiating is way less terrible than it would have been. The derivative of 2x is 2. The derivative of 4 times natural log of tangent is 4 times the derivative of the natural log of tangent, which is 1 over tangent times the derivative of tangent, which is secant squared of x, minus 1/2 times the derivative of natural log of some stuff is 1 over the stuff times the derivative of stuff. And even though I really want to simplify this, because it feels bad to leave a 6 and a 1/2 unsimplified, I'm not going to. So definitely, if you see a question like this where it's natural log of some garbage, or even log base something else of some garbage that like is multiplied by together, the intent of the problem is to simplify that expression using the logarithmic rules before you differentiate. Oops. Let's look at the next one. too much paper. So the next one is f of x equal to secant of x to the x power. Now, there's a number of ways of doing a problem like this, but I'm going to show you the way that I typically would do it. I typically would say, okay, I'm going to rewrite this as y equal to secant of x to the x, and then take the natural log of both sides. Whenever I have a variable in my base and my exponent, I like to do the thing where we take the natural log of both sides. And the reason for doing that is so we can bring the x down. So I'm going to write this as the natural log of y equal to x times the natural log of secant of x. And now we can differentiate both sides using implicit differentiation on the left and the product rule on the right. The derivative of the natural log of y is 1 over y times y prime. On the right-hand side, I'm using the product rule. So the derivative of x is 1 times the natural log of secant of x plus x times the derivative of the natural log of secant is 1 over the stuff times the derivative of the stuff, which is secant of x times tangent of x. I don't know why we never write tangent x times secant x. We always write secant x times tangent x. Maybe it's because it's alphabetical. I don't know. We're not done because we haven't isolated y prime. Since we haven't isolated y prime, we might as well go ahead and cancel the secant here and the secant there. I know the promise is not to simplify, but it feels silly to write more things than we need to if we're going to keep going here. So we're going to get y prime equal to y times all of this stuff. The natural log of secant of x plus x times tangent of x. Finally, we should replace y with what it's equal to. So we're going to write that y prime is equal to y, which is secant of x to the x, times all this stuff. Natural log of secant of x plus x times tangent of x. And this is how I would do it. I should point out, this is not the only way to do this problem. If you prefer, it is equally valid to do the following. You can rewrite f of x equal to secant of x to the x as e to the natural log of secant of x to the x, which is then e to the x times the natural log of secant of x. That's also totally valid. And then you can just take the derivative using the rule for taking the derivative of e to the something. The derivative of e to the stuff is e to the stuff times the derivative of the stuff. So the derivative here is going to be e to the x times the natural log of secant of x times the derivative of x times natural log of secant of x. Okay, now let me ask you all, what is e to the x times natural log of secant x better known as in this particular problem? Well, instead of writing this, I'm going to write that. Welcome, thanks. Right, e to the x times natural log of secant x is just secant of x to the x, right? We can see it right there. So I'm going to rewrite this as secant of x to the x times the derivative of x times natural log of secant of x is the same derivative we did before. It's going to be 1 times the natural log of secant of x plus x times 1 over secant of x times secant of x times tangent of x. And since I've finished the problem, I'm not going to simplify. You could cancel the secants, but you don't have to. Either way is totally valid. It just depends on what you prefer. So whenever you have a function you're differentiating and the base and the exponent both have a variable in them, you can either take the natural log of both sides and do this implicit way, or you can rewrite your thing as e to the natural log of your stuff and use log rules to bring down the power and then differentiate that way. Either way is good. That's all there is to say. Moving on. Stop me if you have a question. I know I keep saying I can't like not say stop me if you have a question. Just, I know it's like it's implied. I know you know, but I'm still gonna say it because that's the way it is. So let's look at this next one. F of x equal to e to the 3x plus 2 to the cosine of x plus x to the pi plus log base 2 of x to the 4th plus 1. All right. So when you have bases that are other than e, like in this 2 to the cosine x to this log base 2 of x to the 4th plus 1, well, in fact, let me just show you. So the derivative of e to the stuff is e to the stuff times the derivative of the stuff. The derivative of 2 to the stuff is essentially the same, except in addition to using the chain rule, we also have to multiply by the natural log of the base. So here, even though I didn't write it, we're actually multiplying by natural log of e. It's just the natural log of e is 1. Here, we have to write it because natural log of 2 isn't 1. It's something else. So here our derivative is going to be 2 to the cosine of x times the derivative of cosine of x, which is negative sine of x, times natural log of 2. The derivative of x to the pi, well, that's just like x to the third. The derivative of that would be 3x squared. The derivative of x to the pi would be pi times x to the pi minus 1. And finally, so when you have a base to a power like that, you end up multiplying by the natural log of the base. When you have log with a different base, you end up dividing by the natural log of that base. So when I take the derivative of log base 2 of x to the 4th plus 1, it's like taking the derivative of the natural log of x to the 4th plus 1, where I would get 1 over x to the 4th plus 1 times, I'm going to put the 4x cubed on top. And then additionally, we have to divide by the natural log of 2. So I have a 1 over natural log of 2 as well. All right, let's keep it moving. Again, people on Zoom also, if you have questions, feel free to stop me. I'm happy to explain further. So let's look at this next limit. Limit as x goes to 0 of the natural log of cosine of x over x squared. And whenever you see a limit on an exam, even if you don't write it out, you should at least mentally think, what if I just plugged in 0? If I plug in 0, I'm going to get the natural log of cosine of 0 over 0 squared, which is the natural log of 1, which is 0 over 0. Okay, so it's a 0 over 0, so that means we need to do more work. It probably means, although not necessarily, but it probably means we should at least consider using L'Hopital's rule. I would definitely jump to L'Hopital's rule. So let's use L'Hopital. So we're going to take the limit as x goes to 0. I'm going to take the derivative at the top. So I'm going to get 1 over cosine of x times derivative of cosine, which is negative sine of x, all over 2x. And if I plug in 0 now, I'm still going to get 0 over 0. So I'm going to use L'Hopital again. But before I use L'Hopital again, I'm going to simplify this just a little bit. Because I really would rather not take the derivative of sine over cosine. I'd rather write it as tangent. So this is going to be the limit as x goes to 0 of negative tangent of x over 2x. And it's easy enough to use L'Hopital's rule here, although you could do it a different way. Using L'Hopital's rule, we get the limit as x goes to 0 of the derivative of negative tangent is negative secant squared of x the root of 2x is 2. And now if we plug in 0, we get negative secant squared of 0 over 2, which is negative 1 half. The secant of 0 is 1. At this point, if you wanted to, you could have used the fact that the limit as x goes to 0 of sine x over x is 1, and the rest of it's going to be negative 1 half. That's another option that you can use. But this one wasn't too terrible to use L'Hopital's rule, so it seemed to make sense to do it there. Let's get the next one. More limits. Okay, limit as x goes to 0, that's number 6, of tangent squared of 3x over sine squared of 2x. And my gut tells me L'Hopital's rule is going to be, well, first, back it up. I will post the study guide in Canvas. It's not currently posted there. You can find it. Let me just give you the straight up link to it. Here is the link to it. But I will definitely post it in Canvas, and I'll also post these solutions that we're writing as we go here as well. So this next limit is definitely a 0 over 0, right? Tangent of 0 is 0. Sine of 0 is 0. And I'm going to show you, let's say we want to use L'Hopital's rule, right? Because L'Hopital's rule is definitely an option. So if we use L'Hopital's rule, let's see what happens. We have the limit as x goes to 0. Okay, the derivative of some stuff of tangent squared, so some stuff squared is 2 times your stuff times the derivative of your stuff. And the derivative of tangent of 3x is secant squared of 3x times 3. Similarly, the derivative of sine squared of 2x, the derivative of some stuff squared is 2 times your stuff to the first power times the derivative of your stuff, and the derivative of sine of 2x is cosine of 2x times 2. And that looks pretty damn terrible. Especially because if you plug in 0 right now, you're still going to get 0 over 0. And using L'Hopital's rule again is going to be really awful. Nothing really cancels. Like, right, tangent is sine over cosine, secant squared is 1 over cosine squared. Nothing cancels out. The next L'Hopital, which we're not going to write out, is really terrible. I definitely asked questions on tests like this before with the intent of my students doing something different. So there's another way to go here. So instead, let's do the following. So we're going to write this limit as x goes to 0. I'm going to write this a little bit differently. Instead of tangent squared of 3x, I'm going to write this as sine squared of 3x over cosine squared of 3x times 1 over sine squared of 2x. And I'm actually going to make this look kind of grossly long. I'm going to write this as the limit as x goes to 0. Just watch for a second. I'll let you fill it in a moment. I'm going to want all the sine pieces to have their own fraction, meaning I'm going to have a sine of 3x times another sine of 3x times something over sine of 2x times something over sine of 2x. And then we still have the cosine squared of 3x. Okay, the cosine is not, okay, so you can write this out if you want. Sorry, I know I told you to stop. You can go ahead and write. The cosine is not really important here because cosine of 0 is 1. But everything else, right, sine of 0, 0, sine of 0, 0. So here's what we want to do. We know, write this up here. We know that the limit as some stuff goes to 0 of sine of that stuff over the same exact stuff is equal to 1. So what we're going to do is we're going to make it so that each of these fractions has sine of stuff over the exact same stuff. It's also true the reciprocals has a limit of 1. The limit as theta goes to 0 of theta over sine of theta is also equal to 1. So what we're going to do is we're going to throw in a 3x right there and a 3x right there and a 2x up there and a 2x up there. But we need to balance that out. Fortunately, the x is already balanced, right? I have divided by x squared and I've multiplied by x squared. We're safe there. I don't need to worry about adding or subtracting, or I should say multiplying or dividing by any more x's. But I've ended up multiplying the top by 4 and the bottom by 9. So I need a 9 in the numerator to cancel out the 9 I divided by, and I need a 4 in the denominator to cancel the 4 I multiplied by. So I hope everyone can see that this limit I've written here is exactly the same as that limit there. We've got the same exact pieces. We've got sine times sine 3x times sine 3x over sine 2x times sine 2x over cosine squared of 3x. And then I've multiplied by 2x times 2x times 9, which is 4 times 9 is 36x squared on top. And I've multiplied by 3x times 3x times 4, which is 36x squared on the bottom. So, thank you. This limit is going to equal, well, the limit is x goes to 0, sine of 3x over 3x is 1. That limit is 1. That limit is 1. That limit is 1. That limit is 9 over 1 and 1 fourth. So we end up with 9 fourths. Why is it 9? So because if you plug in 0, cosine of 0 is 1. That's why it's 9 over 1, because cosine squared of 0 is 1 squared, which is 1. Other questions about this problem? Okay, sure. So someone asked a question about something that I don't think actually is on here at all. Yeah. Let me see what's on the other side. Nope, okay. Sure, so let's take a quick journey to the side here. This is not on the hand. Oh, by the way, there's a hand up there. It came late with that, the problem we're working on, if you want to grab a copy of it. But this problem is not on this. So someone asked, can we go over how to use the inverse function theorem to prove the derivative arctangent of x? And I'm going to say yes, but I'm going to show you two different ways of doing it. So find / prove the derivative of the arc tangent of x. I would never do this using the inverse derivative theorem, mostly because I can't remember the inverse derivative theorem, right? It's a theorem that just does not stick in my head. I kind of know it a bit, but not great. So I'm going to show you how I would do it first, and then, which is essentially still using the same theorem. It's just kind of the more systematic way of getting there. So I would start with this. I want to differentiate arctangent of x. So I'm going to let y equal arctangent of x. And our job is to find dy dx, aka y prime. That's what we're trying to do. So I'm going to rewrite this, right? If y equals arctangent of x, that's equivalent to tangent of y equal to x. Now, there is a slight restriction here, which we should mention. Arctangent of x has values between what two angles? I know it's been a while, The arctangent gives you angles that are between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2. So that means we have the restriction that the angle y is between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2. It's not a huge deal. Usually you can kind of just ignore it, but if someone's asking you to prove this, they might ask you to be very detailed about it. All right, so now that we have tangent of y equal to x, we're going to differentiate. The derivative of tangent of y is, well, the derivative of tangent is some stuff, secant squared of your stuff times the derivative of your stuff. And the derivative of x is just 1. Great, we can pretty much solve for y prime now. Y prime is going to be 1 over secant squared of y. Or if you prefer, cosine squared of y. Now we're not done because our answer is not, it's clearly not the answer we know we should be getting, right? We should definitely know that the derivative of the arctangent of x is 1 over 1 plus x squared, or 1 over x squared plus 1, whichever way you want to write it. And that definitely doesn't look like what we want. So at this point, you can do one of two things. My personal preference is to draw a triangle. So I would draw this triangle where y is my angle, right? Tangent of y equals x. And I would say tangent of y equals x over 1. The tangent is the opposite over adjacent. So that's x, that's 1. And using the Pythagorean theorem, my third side, my hypotenuse is the square root of 1 plus x squared. And now if I want to find cosine, well, cosine of y is adjacent over hypotenuse. So that's going to be 1 over the square root of 1 plus x squared, which means that y prime is going to be 1 over the square root of 1 plus x squared squared, or more generally, the derivative of arctangent of x is 1 over 1 plus x squared. That's the way I think is the best way to show what the derivative of tangent is. And specifically because doing it the other way, really, like, I will be perfectly honest, I have a hard time doing it the other way. I find it difficult to remember how exactly the inverse function theorem, the inverse derivative function theorem is. But we can attempt to do it. It's gonna have to be careful. So alternatively, we can say, well, the inverse derivative theorem, whatever, I feel like there's not a good name for this theorem, essentially says that if you're finding the derivative, I have to remember how this works, the derivative of F inverse of X at x equal to a. It's equal to 1 over the derivative of the function evaluated at, this is where I always am like, how do you do this part? It's basically at F inverse of. That's the part I'm always like, is that right? I think that's right. Yeah, because if you're plugging in A here, you should be plugging in, right, F inverse of A, which would be like, okay, that works. Okay, so in this particular case, we're letting F of X be tangent of X. F inverse of X is the arc tangent of X, or the inverse tangent of x, whichever way you want to write it. Okay, so now our derivative of inverse tangent It helps that we know what we want the answer to be. The derivative of the inverse tangent of x should be 1 over the derivative of tangent, which is secant squared of, this is where it's kind of funky. Secant squared of what? This is where I literally have issues. So here's what we're trying to do, right? It's not supposed to be secant squared of x, because it's supposed to be essentially the inverse of x. So here's what I'm thinking. If y equals tangent of x, then inverse tangent of y is equal to x. Or if you prefer, see, I feel like things always get super backwards here. What am I actually trying to put in there? Yeah, I'm trying to put what inverse tangent of x is equal to. So like y, I guess. Or I guess here's what we really want to do. That's what you actually want. The inverse tangent of x. It feels weird, but I think it's right. It's super funky. So what is secant squared of the inverse tangent of x? I'm pretty sure it's the same thing we did right here, right? The inverse tangent of x is y. We found secant squared of y. So when you're trying to find secant squared of the inverse tangent of x, I feel like that's where things are kind of weird. But I would say it this way, right? Inverse tangent of x is an angle. I always am trying to remember that when I'm dealing with inverse trig functions. Inverse trig function of a thing gives you an angle, always. Which means x equals tangent of that angle. Okay. So now check this out. I'm going to use a trig identity instead. I know a trig identity involving secant squared and tangent squared. It's actually my favorite trig identity ever. I probably said it in class at least once. I can and get sexy. 1 plus tangent squared theta equals secant squared theta. So we know that 1 plus tangent squared theta equals secant squared theta. It's impossible to forget. But now look, I can replace theta with inverse tangent, and I can replace tangent with x. So it's really the case that secant squared of inverse tangent of x is equal to 1 plus x squared. Oh, and that's exactly what we want. Again, this is not the way I would encourage you to do it unless you have to do it this way. I feel like it's very kind of convoluted and easy to trip yourself up on what's exactly happening. Questions about this before we do one more thing related to the theorem? It's weird. So someone could ask you to do this on an exam, but I feel like a more likely type of question for an exam would be something like, use the inverse derivative theorem or whatever it's called to find, let me grab a question. So I'm gonna try and make something up and I'm gonna kind of blow it. So let me just grab something instead. 1 second. Sometimes I'm good at making up questions. This particular topic, I feel like I always am like, where are you? It's I think that's what I want. One sec. Oh, there we go. Yeah. Sure. So we want to find the derivative of f inverse of x, where f of x is equal to x to the fifth plus x cubed plus x. And we'll find the derivative of this at x equal to 1. Okay, so that's our desire here. So we're trying to find the derivative of f inverse of x at x equal to 1. I have to make sure I've got this right. No, sorry, x equal to 3, apologies. Yeah, that's it. Okay, so to do that, I need to do 1 over the derivative of f evaluated at f inverse of 3. And the trick here, or the thing that's supposed to be the trick here, is that we have to figure out what f inverse of 3 is. So f inverse of 3 equal to, let's say, a is equivalent to f of a equaling 3. So we have to look back at this. So here's the thing. We can't find f inverse. Finding f inverse for this is probably literally impossible. There's no way of switching x and y and solving for the new y. But we can definitely guess what you can plug in for a to get this equal to 3. Can anyone tell me what that's going to be? Right. It's usually 0 or 1 or something very obvious. So if you're just like, oh, what can I plug in here and get 3? Oh, yeah. A is going to be 1. So what we're trying to find is 1 over f prime of 1. So then I'm just going to plug in. So the derivative is going to be the derivative is 5x to the fourth plus 3x squared plus 1 evaluated at x equal to 1, which is going to be 1 over 5 plus 3 plus 1, which is 1/9. Again, they're kind of funky problems, but that's what the usual kind of gist of them is. So hopefully that gives you some examples of how you would do a thing like that. All right, let's keep going with these limits. That's a good question. So let's look at the next one. The limit as x goes to 0 from the right, the sine of x to the 1 over x power. This is definitely looking like a 0 to the infinity. Is this a form where I need to use L'Hopital's rule? If I look at this, I've got my sine of 0 is 0. And 1 over 0 from the right is getting infinitely large. That's a 0 to the infinity of power. Is that indeterminate? It's actually not. Right? Here's the way to think about it. You're getting really, really close to 0. So your number is very small. Definitely less than 1, for sure. If you take a number that's less than 1, positive, and keep multiplying it by itself, does it get bigger or smaller? Smaller. So this number that's close to 0 multiplied by itself again and again and again and again and again is just going to get smaller and smaller and smaller. This limit's actually going to be 0. There is no other work to do. If you just, if you thought you might need to use L'Hopital's rule, let's see what happens if we do the usual thing where you're like, okay, well, so can we use L'Hopital? Well, to use L'Hopital, I would do the thing where I took the e to the natural log. So I'd be like, okay, this is going to be the limit as x goes to zero from the right of e to the natural log of sine of x to the 1 over x. I'd rewrite this as e to the limit as x goes to zero from the right of natural log of sine of x times 1 over x or over x. And then I would recognize, or maybe not, but I would say this is going to be e to the natural log of zero over zero. But what's the natural log of zero going to? And this is something you definitely need to know taking these limits. As x goes to zero, the natural log goes to anybody? Anybody? Think about the graph of natural log. Natural log of zero goes to negative infinity. Right, you have that vertical asymptote, it goes like that. Oh yeah, as x goes to zero, the natural log function goes down. So we can't use L'Hopital's rule here, right? Because we don't have a zero over zero or an infinity over infinity type. But more importantly, we don't need to use L'Hopital's rule here, because a very large negative number divided by a very small positive number is a very large negative number. So this is e to the negative infinity, which is 1 over e to the positive infinity, which is 0, which is the same answer we already got. So you can do this process if you want to, but it is unnecessary. If you see a zero to the infinity type, the limit is just zero. On the other hand, if you have a 1 to the infinity type, I just want to point out, you do need to use L'Hopital's rule to redo this whole thing. I've definitely had people in the past say, well, James, what, so actually, let's go in this direction for just a second. Say, what if we have this limit? The limit as x goes to infinity of 1 minus 1 over x to the x power. I've definitely had people try to argue the infinity to the zero is indeterminate, and you do need to do the same. You do need to use L'Hopital's rule and use this process. So in fact, if we switch the, in fact, we'll do that one next. But this one is a 1 to the infinity, which is indeterminate. But I really want to point out, you can't make the same argument I made before. The argument I made for the previous problem was our number was less than 1. And a number that's less than 1 multiplied by itself an infinite number of times is going to be very, very small as 0. This number you can't say is less than 1. I know it is less than 1, right? Like 1 minus a small number is less than 1. But the problem is that number is approaching 1. And so even though it's a number that's less than 1 multiplied by itself a bunch of times, it's getting closer and closer and closer to 1. So you cannot make the argument here that this limit is 0, because it's not. Here, the way we do this one is the same way we tried to do the last one. We write this as the limit as x goes to infinity of e to the natural log of 1 minus 1 over x to the x. We would then write it as e to the limit as x goes to infinity. We bring the x down. That's the whole reason for writing it as e to the natural log of the stuff. And then we'd rewrite it as e to the limit as x goes to infinity of the natural log of 1 minus 1 over x over 1 over x. And then we can finally use L'Hopital's rule, because we have an e to the 0 over 0. Well, 1 multiplied, so here's the thing. it's not one times itself an infinite number of times. It's something that is close to one multiplied by itself an infinite number of times. So the problem, there's a balancing act here in that the number, that the as the number gets closer and closer to one, you multiply by itself more and more times, so you might move away from one. Right, but again, right, this is not actually one times itself, it's a number that is close to one, which is different. Here we're gonna get, using L'Hopital's rule, e to the limit x goes to infinity. The derivative of the natural log of some stuff is 1 over the stuff times the derivative of the stuff. And the derivative of negative 1 over x is positive 1 over x squared. And the derivative of 1 over x on the bottom is negative 1 over x squared. And we can cancel some stuff. We can cancel the x squared and say, oh, that's really just e to the limit as x goes to infinity of 1 over 1 minus x, sorry, 1 minus 1 over 1 minus 1 over x times 1 over x squared and negative 1 over x squared. Those cancel and give us just a negative 1. And then the 1 over x goes to 0 as x goes to infinity. So we're left with e to the 1 over 1 minus 0 times negative 1, which is just e to the negative 1, or 1 over e, which is definitely not equal to 1 or 0. This limit is definitely something different. So I really want to stress, a 1 to the infinity type usually almost never equals 1 or 0 or anything else. It's usually e to the something. I guess it could be 1 if it was e to the 0, but it's usually almost never e to the 0. So you're usually going to get e to some non-zero number. So hopefully that clarifies why 1 multiplied by itself an infinite number of times isn't 1, because it's not actually 1 that's multiplied by itself. It's a number that's close to 1. Let's go ahead and somebody asked, what about infinity to the 0th power? So let's actually take that one we did before, that sine x to the 1 over x, and rewrite it as 1 over x to the sine x. So what if we had the limit as x goes to infinity of 1 over x to the sine x? Oh, sorry, yeah. Not to infinity, to 0. Apologies. This is an infinity to the 0 type, which is indeterminate. Yes. Sorry, I certainly not said it. Well, I can guess it was in the prior. All right. So we're going to do the same thing we just did. Right, so whenever you see this indeterminate, this exponential type of indeterminate, where it's either 1 to the infinity or infinity to the 0 or 0 to the 0, you have to do the same process. Now, you can do it like we did it there, or you can do the other thing where you just take the natural log. Sorry, is that good? Sorry. I can slow down for a second if you guys want. I'm in no hurry. All right, let's probably take a break for a second. We'll do this problem, then I'll take a quick bathroom break. And we'll do one more of those actually. So I'm gonna do it this way step. We're gonna just gonna look at the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of the natural log of 1 over x to the sine of x. I'm leaving off the e part, but whatever we get, our answer is then gonna be e to the that. Instead of having to write e, right? Because I feel like it's very kind of cumbersome to write the e to the limit of all, right? It gets really kind of, it gets messy when I'm writing this. Maybe your writing is nicer than mine. My writing gets a little complicated. So we're going to bring down the sign. That's always why we're doing this natural log in the first place. So we can bring down the exponent. That's limit as x goes to 0 from the right of sine of x times the natural log of 1 over x. And now it's a 0 times infinity type, where we always need to bring one of the factors down to the denominator as reciprocal. You almost never want to bring a natural log to the denominator. I really don't want to write this as sine of x over 1 over natural log of 1 over x. That's going to be terrible to differentiate the bottom. I should definitely think of this as the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of the natural log of 1 over x over 1 over sine of x. But I should do myself a favor. I don't want to differentiate 1 over sine. I want to differentiate cosecant. So I should really think of this as the limit as x goes to 0 from the right. I could be extra smart here. Instead of writing natural log of 1 over x, I could write the natural log of x to the negative 1. And then I could bring the negative 1 down the front and say it's the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of negative natural log of x over cosecant of x. That seems worth doing. I'd much rather differentiate negative natural log of x than natural log of 1 over x. You're going to get the same result. It's just we're doing the simplifying before we differentiate instead of after we differentiate. Now, finally, using L'Hopital's rule. I don't think it's a bad idea if your professor is asking you to show your work on your exam, which I know some people are not. But if they are, I think it's a good idea to show them that you are using L'Hopital's rule by writing the L apostrophe H above your equal sign. Not required, but it's a good idea. So using L'Hopital's rule, the derivative of the natural log of x is 1 over x. The derivative of cosecant x is negative cosecant x cotangent x. This doesn't look great. If I plug in 0, I definitely get 1 over 0 on top, which is some sort of infinity. And cosecant of 0 is 1 over sine of 0, which is undefined, which is also some sort of infinity. I need to do some rewriting here. I don't want to use L'Hopital's rule again. I think the bottom is going to be terrible. So let's do a little bit of simplifying. First, let's get rid of those negative signs. And dividing by cosecant is the same as multiplying by what? Definitely the same as multiplying by sine. Right? Cosecant is 1 over sine, so dividing by 1 over sine is like multiplying by sine. And dividing by cotangent is the same as multiplying by its reciprocal, which is. Now, you could use L'Hopital's rule again. You've got a 0 over 0. Or, and I would recommend doing it this other way instead, you say, well, look, I've got the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of sine of x over x times tangent of x. And every single one of you should be able to tell me that the limit as x goes to 0 of sine of x over x is what? 1. So we're going to get 1 times tangent of zero is 0. So our answer is 0. Or is it? What's our actual answer? E to the 0. So the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of just 1 over x to the sine of x is e to the 0, which is 1. Kind of neat. Let's do one more like this, and then I will take a bathroom break. We'll do one more. We'll do the last exponential form, which is a 0 to the 0. So let's do the limit as x goes to 0, x to the sine of x. So same idea, right? We're going to write this as, and you can do it either way, right? You can just take the natural log and do it that way, or you can do the e to the natural log and do it that way. Either way should be fine. Professor shouldn't have one preference over the other. They both get to the same result as long as you're careful. I'm going to do it the other way. I'm going to do it the limit as x goes to 0 of e to the natural log of x to the sine of x. So it's going to be very similar to what we just did. we're going to get the limit as x goes to 0 of e to the x times, sorry, not x times, sine of x times the natural log of x. And again, I never want to bring natural log of x to the denominator to make L'Hopital's rule work. So I'm always going to bring the other thing. This is going to be e to the limit as x goes to 0 of natural log of x divided by what? What's it going to be when I have come to the bottom? It's no longer sine, it's what? 1 over sine, or preferably cosecant. And now we're going to use L'Hopital's rule because I have a infinity over infinity. Natural log of 0 is going to negative infinity, and cosecant of 0 is also going to some sort of infinity. So we can definitely use L'Hopital's rule. We're going to get the limit as x goes to 0 of, oh, I wrote the limit out in front. Sorry, sometimes I accidentally, I guess I can do this. E to the limit as x goes to 0 of derivative natural log of x, 1 over x. Derivative cosecant, again, is negative cosecant x. Cotangent. Oh, we're getting the same sort of thing we had before. Right, I'm going to simplify this in the exact same way, except I have a negative sign here. So I'm going to have e to the limit as x goes to 0 of 1 over x times the reciprocal of cosecant is sine. And I guess if there's a negative out in front here. And the reciprocal of cotangent is tangent. And since we did it the other way last time, let's go ahead and use L'Hopital's rule again this time just to show that you could do that as well. So rewriting this just a tiny bit, it's e to the limit as x goes to 0 of negative sine x tangent x over x. And if you want to use L'Hopital's rule one more time, you're going to get e to the limit as x goes to 0 of, here at the top is kind of a pain, here at the bottom is 1. Here at the top is going to be, so let's say I've got negative sine times tangent, so it's going to be negative cosine x times tangent x plus negative sine x times derivative tangent is secant squared x. And when I plug in 0, I get e to the, see, cosine of 0 is 1, tangent of 0 is 0, sine of 0 is 0, secant of 0 is 1. That's going to be e to the 0. A lot of the time, not always, but a lot of the time, if your limit is of the form 0 to the 0 or infinity to the 0, frequently those limits end up equaling 1. Not all the time, but very, very often. So when I see a limit that's 0 to the 0 or infinity to the 0, I'm usually pretty sure, I'm like, I think this is probably going to be, I'm still going to show all my work. But in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, okay, I'm expecting to most likely get 1. If I don't get 1, it should be obvious that I'm not getting 1 for good reasons. All right, let's take a quick few minute break so I can fill up my water and empty my bladder, and then we'll continue on. If you have questions you want to see done, let me know. We probably won't get through quite all of this, but we'll try to get through most of it.
I did that as a matter of fact.
All right. Back to it.
Here is the next one. The limit as h goes to zero of the inverse tangent of 2 plus h minus the inverse tangent of 2 all divided by h. Could you use L'Hopital's rule here?
Sure.
It's a zero over zero. If you plug in zero, you get inverse tangent of 2 minus inverse tangent of 2, which is zero. Over zero, totally you can use L'Hopital's rule. But this problem has been written in a way that's really telling you you should do something different. So see that h. That h is trying to make it very, very obvious that someone has written a limit definition of a derivative here. So if we think about this, we're going to think of letting f of x be the inverse tangent of x. And if I wanted to find the derivative, using, now I'm not actually going to use limit definition to find the derivative, but I'll point out that f prime of x using the limit definition of the derivative would be the limit as h goes to zero of inverse tangent of x plus h minus inverse tangent of x all over h. Right, that's my f of x plus h. Now, to find the thing I'm actually being asked to find, what do I need to replace x with? 2. So f prime of 2 is the limit I actually want. Okay, well, I don't need to find this because I know what f prime of x is. If my function is inverse tangent, then we know that the derivative is 1 over 1 plus x squared. And we know that f prime of 2 is 1 over 1 plus 2 squared, which is 1/5. So our answer is 1/5. And that is definitely the intent of this problem. And if you see something like that, where it looks like function evaluated at number plus h, minus function evaluated number all over h, or maybe they use a different letter, they're really saying, look at this and see that it is the limit definition of the derivative of some function, and then just find the derivative at that value, and that's your answer. And they usually try to make it, I mean, this one you totally could use L'Hopital's rule, right? It's not terrible to take the derivative of this and the derivative of this and the derivative of that, but it's just easier to do it this way. All right, one more limit. This one's not exciting. We should do it anyway. So the limit as x goes to infinity of the square root of 9x squared plus 80x minus the square root of 9x squared plus 20x. And this is definitely an infinity minus infinity form, which is also indeterminate. And this sort of form requires multiplication by the conjugate. So we're going to rewrite this as the limit as x goes to infinity of the square root of 9x squared plus 80x minus the square root of 9x squared plus 20x over 1 times the conjugate, which is going to be the square root of 9x squared plus 80x plus the square root of 9x squared plus 20x over the same thing. And of course, the whole reason for multiplying by the conjugate is the conjugates multiply out nicely. So on top, we're going to get 9x squared plus 80x minus 9x squared plus 20x. In parentheses, right? It's really, really important that that minus sign distributes to each term. Otherwise, we're going to be wrong. In the denominator, we just have the square root of 9x squared plus 80x plus the square root of 9x squared plus 20x. Okay. You almost never want to use L'Hopital's rule with these kind of problems. Right, you could totally simplify the top, and you're going to get 60x and the bottom, and you could use L'Hopital's rule, but what ends up happening is you get this kind of thing where you use L'Hopital's rule and the square root end up on the numerator, and then you use L'Hopital's rule and the square root end up on the denominator. They keep just kind of flipping back and forth between where they are. So there's a different tactic you want to use, which is that this looks kind of like a rational function where the numerator and the denominator are polynomials e to the power. And if this was like something like 3x squared plus 5x plus 1 over 2x squared plus 5x minus 7, your limit would be 3 halves because it's the limit of, or it's the quotient of leading coefficients. Essentially, we have that happening here. If you simplify the top, you're going to get 60x, x to the first. And looking at the denominator, your highest power of x really is x to the first because you have a square root of x squared. So the tactic here is to bring the x squared out of the square root by factoring it out, meaning we're going to do the following. We're going to simplify the top and get 60x. And in the denominator, watch, we're going to get the square root of x squared times 9 plus 80 over x plus the square root of x squared times 9 plus 20 over x. Now, here is a question that's not a trick question in this context. What's the square root of x squared? X. Now, I want you to be extra careful here, because in this case, it's true, since x is going to positive infinity. But more generally, the square root of x squared is actually the absolute value of x. And so if x were going to negative infinity, you would end up getting negative x. So let me show you what I mean. We get the limit as x goes to infinity of 60x over. The square root of x squared is the absolute value of x. Square root of x squared is the absolute value of x. And since x is positive, that's just going to turn into x. But I really, really, really want to point out, if this was the limit as x goes to negative infinity, that would need to be a negative x. When you drop the absolute value, that would need to be a negative x. So it's going to be the limit as x goes to infinity of 60x over, let's factor out the x from each of these, x times the square root of 9 plus 80 over x plus the square root of 9 plus 20 over x. And then the x's cancel. We're left with, you probably don't need to write the limit one more time, but I'm going to. Limit is x goes to infinity is 60 over the square root of 9 plus 80 over x plus the square root of 9 plus 20 over x. And the 80 over x and the 20 over x are going to go to 0. So we're left with 60 over the square root of 9 plus the square root of 9, which is 60 over 3 plus 3, which is 10. And that's our answer. And this is probably the most effective or efficient way of doing a problem like this. I can't think of a better way to do it. All right, let's keep going. Question 11, sure, question 11. Show that if A is greater than 0, then f of x equal to x cubed plus ax has exactly one root. This might be a little bit much for a test question. It might not. I don't know. I could definitely see some people asking it. So when we're asked to show there's exactly one of something, it's a two-step process. First, you have to show that there is one. Then you have to show that if you have more than one, you run into some logical contradiction. This type of problem specifically involves using first the intermediate value theorem to show that there is a solution, and then Rolle's theorem, which is a version of the mean value theorem, to show that there can't be more than one solution. So let's show that there is a solution. So we're going to do the existence part first. So the problem here, this one's a little bit more challenging because they didn't just give us a number for a. They said x cubed plus ax. Great, that's super helpful. I feel like the problem is kind of dumb in that we know what the root is. So we're not even going to use the intermediate value thing here, because what does the root have to be? Well, I shouldn't say that. I should say a solution to x cubed plus a times x equal to zero is what? Right, x could be zero. That's kind of nice in that we don't actually have to use the intermediate value theorem to show the resolution. Okay, but now what we're going to do is show that there can only be one. It's like Highlander. All right. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to assume there are two solutions. I don't think we need to pretend like one of them is, or to say that one of them is zero, although one of them certainly could be zero. But let's just call them A and B. So call them x equal to A and x equal to B. So here's what that means for us. It means that f of A is equal to zero and f of B is equal to zero. I think it helps to make a little drawing. Let's say here's A and here's B, and we know they're a function, or we're assuming they're a function, goes to those points there. So maybe it looks like this. I don't actually. But here's the point. The point here is that if you have a function that's continuous and differentiable, which this certainly is, it's a polynomial. Polynomials are always continuous and differentiable everywhere. If it has the same value at two different points, then somewhere between those two points, you had to have a relative maximum or minimum. Meaning you had to have a place where the derivative is equal to what? Right. And that's Rolle's theorem. By Rolle's theorem, there must be a number C between A and B such that the derivative at C is equal to zero. But now we're going to see that that's impossible, because our function is x cubed plus, I should use something other than A, sorry. This A is not the same as that A. Let's call it something like, I'm going to change it to D, which feels weird, but it'll make it less terrible. Sorry. It's never a good idea to reuse letters for other purposes, right? That's definitely something we should avoid. So f of x is x cubed plus ax, and the derivative is 3x squared plus a, but a is positive. this is definitely greater than or equal to 0 plus a, because 3x squared is always greater than or equal to 0, but a is positive, so that derivative can never be 0. Uh-oh. There can't be such a C where the derivative is equal to 0. Because we just showed that the derivative, if there were two points where the function was equal to 0, then there would have to be a point where the derivative was 0. But the derivative can't be 0. So that means there cannot be two or more solutions to f of x equal to 0. And that's the pretty standard way of showing that typically, like a cubic function, depending on what kind it is, has just one root, is by showing that there is one, usually by using the intermediate value theorem, although in this case it was 0. And then by showing there can only be one, because if there were two, you would contradict Rolle's theorem. You'd say that there had to be something, but there can't be something. I wouldn't expect to see a question like this on an exam, but some professors have different expectations than others. It wouldn't surprise me to see this on an exam that Molossi was giving. Oh, that's what I would say. I feel like he sometimes asks some very hard test questions. All right, let's look at the next one. Find the values of A and B so that f of x equal to the following piecewise function, ax plus 2 when x is greater than 1, x squared minus b when x is less than or equal to 1, is differentiable for all x. So two things to point out here. Thing one, there's only one place where we're concerned about this function being differentiable. And that's at x equal to 1. Anywhere else, the function is totally differentiable, right? If f of x equals ax plus 2 when x is larger than 1, that straight line is always differentiable, except for maybe at the point. And x squared minus b is always differentiable, except for maybe where we change from one function to the other. So the only place where we're concerned is we need to make sure f of x is differentiable specifically at x equal to 1, where this changes from one piece to the other. So for the question just now, it's that there's at least one answer, it is that there is only one answer. That previous question, there is exactly one answer, and it is 0. This cubic function can't have two solutions, because if there were two solutions, call them D and B, where f of d was 0 and f of b was 0, then by Rolle's theorem, there has to be a C in between them where the derivative is equal to 0, but this function's derivative could never be 0 because we assumed A was positive, right? That was a given part of the question. And if A is positive, 3x squared plus a is always bigger than or equal to a, which is always bigger than 0. So we actually showed that there is exactly one solution, not at least one solution. That's not true for every cubic function, right? There are certainly plenty of cubic functions that have two zeros or three zeros, but there are some that only have one. So if a function is differentiable, what else does it have to be? Right, differentiability always means or requires continuity. So before we start thinking about that, we're gonna say, well, we really first need f of x to be continuous at x equal to 1. So to be continuous, we need the function value to equal the limit value. So first, f of 1 is equal to 1 squared minus b, which is 1 minus b. Right, I'm just plugging in 1 into the piecewise function, and it's going into the second piece there, because that's where x is equal to 1. And then we also have to look at the limit. The limit as x approaches 1 from the left is the same piece, right? That's the piece where x is less than or equal to 1. So we're going to get the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of 1, sorry, of x squared minus b, which is just going to be 1 minus b. The limit as x approaches 1 from the right, that's where we're using the other piece of the piecewise function. It's the limit as x approaches 1 from the right of ax plus 2, which is just b plus 2. And we need these to be equal to each other. So what this tells me is we must have, or we need, 1 minus b to equal a plus 2. And that's not enough yet, right? I need, right, I mean, at this point, b could be 0 and a could be negative 2 or negative 1, or b could be 3 and a could be negative 4. I don't know what a and b are yet because I need another equation. I need the differentiability requirement to tell me another equation relating to a and b. So, do I have enough room here? Probably not. So, looking at f prime of x, which is going to be, well, that's not the prettiest. Let's try that again, because I'm hoping to maybe post these up later and have them not look terrible. Look at f prime of x, which is the derivative ax plus 2 is just a when x is greater than 1. And the derivative x squared minus b is 2x when x is, so usually I would say less than 1, because we don't actually know that it's going to be what it is at x equal to 1. But since we're going to try and make it differentiable, I'm just going to throw that in. And now for the derivative to exist, the derivative from the left side and the derivative from the right hand side have to be the same. So for f prime of 1 to exist, meaning f of x is differentiable at x equal to 1, we need the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of f prime of x to equal the limit as x approaches 1 from the right of f prime of x. Okay, well, that's not too bad. This left one is the limit as x approaches 1 from the left of a, which is a. And this right one is the limit as x approaches 1 from the right. Oops, I got that backwards. Right, I put my a in the wrong spot. Sure, fine, we can fix that. That's going to be 2x, apologies, which is just going to be 2. It's not so terrible. And this is the one that's a. Which means a has to be 2. But then we needed 1 minus b to equal a plus 2, which means 1 minus b equals 4, which means b has to be negative 3. Those are my answers. Now, you can probably do this problem showing less work. I'm just trying to show all the work, right? But you could definitely be like, I mean, really what you could do if you're trying to do this one the short way is to be like, okay, if I look back here, I'm going to plug in 1 here and 1 here and set them equal to each other. And I'm going to take the derivative and plug in 1 here and 1 here and set them equal to each other. And that's really the short work. So the short version is we need a plus 2 to equal 1 minus b, and we need a to equal 2. Right, that's setting f of 1 from the right equal to f of 1 from the left. And that's setting f prime of 1 from the right equal to f prime of 1 from the left. It's not exactly kosher, but it gets the point across. At the final point of Rolle's theorem, you wrote A is greater than 0, which fulfills the question's condition. Is that why there's only, yeah, exactly. So if A had been negative, it certainly would have been possible that there could have been multiple roots. But since we were given that A is positive, there is only one root. And just to kind of help you see that even better, let's Desmos it up for just a second. So let's graph f of x equal to x cubed plus ax. And let's throw in a slider. So if a is positive, check it out. You only get one root. But if a is negative, whoa, look at that. Multiple roots. So that's what's going on there. Well, it's more of a, so the reason I said uh-oh, so they asked, what does the uh-oh, there can't be a c where f of c equals it. It means that the uh-oh part is, oh, we've kind of failed the Rolle's, or Rolle's theorem. Let me go back for just a second. Right, we're saying, it's really, oh, good, but we're kind of being facetious. We're saying, uh-oh, there can't be a number C where f prime is equal to zero, even though we said that there should be one. But well, that's actually what we wanted. So it's not really an uh-oh, it's kind of a thing we do sometimes. We're like, oh, we said this thing is true, but then it really can't be true because of. That's what's going on there. Sorry if that was misleading. I didn't mean for it to be. Okay. 1133. Let's look at problem 13. Using differentials. Approximate the net increase in the volume of a right cylinder of height 10 centimeters whose radius increases from 3 centimeters to 3.1 centimeters. Okay, so we have a right cylinder. And the radius is going to go from 3 centimeters. To 3.1 centimeters. Use differentials to approximate the net increase in volume. But the height is still 10 centimeters. Oh, sorry, but if C equals zero, fulfill a what? So, sorry, back to this question. So you're asking if C equals zero, no, it would not. So C equals zero, F prime of, well, so C equals, so F prime of C, right, if you set that equal to zero, you're going to get f prime of zero is zero plus a, which is going to be a, which is still positive. Okay, cool. Yeah. No worries. It can be a confusing problem. So I'm trying to use differentials to approximate the net increase in volume. And here's what I'm just going to remind myself of. So delta V, change of volume, is approximately the differential dv, which is going to be v prime of x times delta x. Or I guess I should really say, since it's a function of radius, v prime of r times delta. All right, what's my volume equation here? Well, volume of a cylinder is pi r squared times h. But h isn't changing. So I should really just say it's going to be 10 pi r squared. And v prime of r is going to be 20 pi r. So if I want to find how much the volume is increasing by, my delta v is going to be approximately v prime of r times delta r, which is going to be 20 pi r times delta r, which is going to be, well, now I have to actually figure out what values I'm plugging in. What am I plugging in for r? That's going to be my delta r. So delta r is the change in the radius. R is the radius, which is 3. So it's going to be 20 times pi times 3 centimeters times 0.1 centimeters. Which will end up being, let's see, 20 times 3 is 60, times 0.1 is 6. So it'll be 6 pi centimeters squared. That's approximately the change of volume. Yeah, I'm trying to think if there's anything else to say about that. No, I don't think so. That's all I would say there. So essentially the idea is for R, you're always plugging in the value that's kind of easy, right? Like you're saying the volume at this amount, the volume at this amount, kind of find the difference. So you're saying, well, really it's just how much volume I have here and then adding on a little bit. And I want to know what a little bit of difference is. Okay. Wow, this next one looks terrible. An architect is designing a window for a calculus lecture hall. Okay. The window will consist of a semicircle on top of a rectangle. Let's draw that. Oh, pretty good. The outer perimeter of the window is to be 24 feet. The perimeter. And we want to find the radius of the semicircle so that the area of the whole window is a maximum. So we have to find R. That maximizes the area. Okay. So I need to find an equation for the thing I'm trying to maximize. So let's see. Yeah, I would probably, I guess, I mean, so I don't know what side length this is. I'm going to call this x. So the area is going to be the area of the rectangle, which is 2r times x, plus the area of the semicircle, which is 1/2 pi r squared. But clearly, I don't want that x in there, right? As is typical, I'm trying to maximize the thing. I only want there to be one variable. So I need to use my constraint. The area is going to be that. The perimeter, which is my constraint, is, well, let's see, x plus 2r plus, what's this part going to be here? It's half the circumference of a circle, so it can be not 2 pi r, but pi r. That has to equal 24 feet. So now we're going to solve this equation for x so that we can plug that back in here. So I'm going to have 2x equal to 24 minus 2r minus pi r, and then x is going to equal 12 minus r minus pi over 2 times r. And that's going to get jammed back up into my equation. So now my area is going to be 2R times 12 minus R minus pi 2R plus 1 half pi R squared. And I would definitely multiply that out before I differentiate. So area is going to be 24R minus 2R squared minus 2R times pi over 2R is going to be pi R squared plus 1 half pi R squared. Now, let's be smart about this. Minus pi R squared plus 1 half pi R squared is just minus 1 half pi R squared. You guys all right with that? I just didn't want to write it again. Now we're going to take the derivative. So we're going to do 24 minus 4r minus pi r. And we're going to set that equal to 0. And our answer is not going to be pretty. We're going to do 24 equal to 4r plus pi r. So we're going to get 24 divided by 4 plus pi equal to r. Depending on your class, you should check to see if this is a maximum or not. So, or you should check, unless you don't check. You probably won't have to check on the test, but it's still a good idea to check. So our r value, the smallest it could be is 0, but you can have a negative radius. The largest it could be is, I don't know, it probably couldn't be infinitely large because you're limited by a perimeter of 24 feet. So there's probably some upper values to how big it could be. I mean, if you actually look at this perimeter here, right, if R was, yeah, if X was 0, R would be limited to be much less than 12. Anyway, if you look at the derivative here, pick a number between 0 and 24 over 4 pi. That's like 24 over 7 point something. It's definitely a little bigger than 3. So pick 1. I pick 1 for my derivative. 24 minus 4 minus pi is definitely positive. And now I'm like, I have to pick something over here. It feels a little dangerous. I know that this is around the neighborhood of 3. Probably, right? It's 24 over 7 point something. It's definitely bigger than 3, but not bigger than 4. So if I picked 4 and plugged it into my derivative, I'd have 24 minus 16 minus 12 point something. Oh yeah, that's definitely going to be negative. So yes, that is a maximum. I feel like I should be a little more. So there's something I'm kind of not saying here because I'm trying to not say it. But I should point out that there is a limit as to how R, big R could be. If X were 0, which I know is kind of weird, but if X were 0, then you wouldn't want, R would still be limited in that it couldn't, that, oh gosh, words. Sorry, let me just point that here. X would be 0, then we would need 2r plus pi r to be less than or equal to 24, right? Because we only have so much perimeter to work with, which would mean that r was less than or equal to 24 over 2 plus pi, meaning that's the end of our boundary here. Which is somewhere in the neighborhood of being bigger than 4. So the issue that play here is that I don't want to pick a number that's too big for R here to plug in because technically you shouldn't. That's why I was concerned about that. Again, you probably don't have to worry about this. Or really, honestly, if you have to do this on an exam, here's what you did. You say, okay, I need it to be a maximum. If you only find one critical value, it's probably going to give you a maximum. like, okay, that's my critical value. It's definitely positive here, negative here. You don't actually check it. You just be like, I'm pretty sure it's positive or negative there, and there you really have the maximum. It's not cheating. It's not lying. It's just knowing what the answer is supposed to be. All right, let's see. We're almost out of time here. Let's do problem 15 and then we will call it a day. Find the point on the graph y equals x to the 3/2. Find the point closest to 4, 0. Oops. Not that you need to graph it, but the graph looks something like this. We're trying to find the point on this graph that minimizes the distance. We want to minimize the distance, which is equal to the square root of x minus 4² plus y minus 0². Now, here's the thing that you should always do. If you have to do a question like this, instead, better minimize the distance squared. It is true that minimizing the distance squared will give you the same result as minimizing the distance. So we need to write this as an equation of one variable. So our distance squared is going to be x minus 4² plus, well, the point has to be on this graph. So I'm going to replace y with x to the 3/2. And then we're going to simplify this. Distance squared is going to be x squared minus 8x plus 16 plus x cubed. And now we're going to differentiate so it equals 0, find the critical value, et cetera, et cetera. So the derivative is going to be 2x minus 8 plus 3x squared. That's smart. Set that equal to 0, maybe rewrite it as 3x squared plus 2x minus 8 equals 0. You could use the quadratic formula here. It might factor. I think it factors. Let's see. 3x and x. And I want to multiply in a way that gives me a positive 2. So I think I want a plus 2 and a minus 4. I think that works out. So I get a minus 4x. Plus 6x and a minus 4x, and that adds up to positive 2x. So yeah, we're good. So we get two solutions. X equal to 4/3 or x equal to negative 2. Which of those is the right answer? Definitely 4/3. Minimizes distance. So our point is 4/3, 4/3 to the 3/2 power. How did I get the initial? It was given. The initial equation was given. Do you mean the y equals x to the 3/2 or the distance equation? So the distance formula is given. So yeah, just a reminder here. The distance between two points, x1, y1, and x2, y2, is given by the formula if the square root of the difference in the x's squared plus the difference in the y's.